Welcome back to Visual Arts. This is actually our fourth project. And for clarifications, keep in mind that I post every Friday a new art lesson. So a new art lesson comes out every Friday. If you attend class, say this week, and you do the art project with me in person, then you do not have to do this online project. You don't have to repeat the project. I would just sort of click complete and move on. But if you are a virtual learner, this project's for you. If you are a student who is in the A-B schedule, but I did not see you this week because you're rotating to music and library and PE and science and your other enrichment specials, if I miss you because of the schedule, then this project is for you. So I just don't want any student to get behind. And like I said, I do an art project each week so that we can cover as much content as possible. And so this is a really fun project. It's really easy, and I hope everybody enjoys. So welcome back. This will be project number 4, and it's dealing with the elements of art, shapes. Just as a review, our theme this year is to be the Flash. Everybody is masking up like superheroes to save and protect me from getting the coronavirus, protecting each other, your classmates from getting coronavirus, and we don't want you to pick up something and then take it home to your family. So you're just like a superhero in my eyes by wearing the mask all day, spreading out and doing your very best to keep everybody safe and healthy. And so just as a reminder of our project number 1, I thought it would have been really cool if you guys designed superhero logos. And I'm so sorry I did not get a chance to upload all of the logos that has been turned in to me, has been shared with me through Google Classroom, that have been turned in through Flash folders, who has been handed to me by students in person as I come to art. Very warm and overwhelming to see all of these superhero logos. We also, in week number 2 or 3, we were talking about school safety and, you know, what to do in case an emergency happens, either in the art room or if we have a fire drill or an earthquake. So we reviewed all of those, the safety rules and expectations. And then that same week for project number 2, I posted an online lesson based off of Cassie Stevens, who's an art teacher from Nashville, Tennessee. And she has this really nice drawing project that I did my version of it, but also online posted her link so you actually see Cassie do it herself. And my third grade teachers, I think they saw the probably cool video that I did, and I think they also did this in their classroom. So for my third grade students, you don't have to do this. You know, if you did this in your classroom, you don't have to repeat the project in my room, but it would be nice to go back to and review the safety rules and expectations in that first half of that video. So that is project number 2. First project, superhero logos. Second project, behind my mask, a super kid self-portrait. And we also get to see what you look like behind that mask and that bright, colorful smile. Project number 3. Now, this is actually an ongoing unit. This is the beginning. Last Friday, which is also tricky because I post my lessons on Friday, and it's whatever I teach during that week, that's what I post on Friday. So if I missed you during that week, you can do the art project on Friday. You have a whole week to complete it. And so I just didn't want students to get behind. It's very easy to do, but this is just like if we had normal classes. Everybody would have art once a week. Everybody would have music once a week, PE, library, science. And so I like trying to get as much content covered as we can. And so I hope you enjoy the project. Project number 3, we're beginning the unit on the elements of art. The elements are the parts that make up a work of art. So our first element is lines. So if we were going to paint the Starry Night like Vincent van Gogh, we start off with a blank canvas. And so the first thing we start with is making marks on the canvas, and those marks we usually call lines. And so for all of my students, K through three, it's very important that we learn the different names of all the lines. And so in kindergarten, we did hand motions, and we learned about horizontals, we learned about verticals, we learned about diagonals. We have a whole curve family: arcs, waves, ripples, loops, and spirals. Diagonal has a cousin named zigzag that's nice and even. Jagged is a twin of zigzag, because everybody gets zigzag and jagged mixed up. But jagged lines, the rule is it has to be straight, but they can go in any direction. Zigzags, once they start, they have to stay in that same motion. Broken lines can be any of the lines on the screen, as long as it's got spaces and gaps. Thick and thin, if I was going to draw something light, like a feather or a leaf, I'd use thin. If I was drawing something heavy, like a boulder or an elephant, I'd use thicker lines. So it gives us an idea of weight. So those are the lines. In kindergarten, what we did is we practiced on one side of the sheet of paper. We flipped it over, and then I encouraged you to do a drawing based on the lines that we practice and the lines that we remember the names. So when you draw, I just would like for you to try to remember, hey, I'm drawing a horizontal. Oh, this is a vertical. And I think once you know the names of the lines, I think it helps your drawings to be a little bit stronger. Now, just to give you an idea of what some of the other projects and other classes are doing, my first and second graders were creating a line chart like you saw before, and then we incorporated that into a drawing. So I showed them how to draw a lightning bolt. We divided the paper up into 8 equal parts, and then we gave an example of all the lines we learned behind it to make it a really, really cool and interesting design. My third graders, we were creating a drawing using one-point perspective where we drew the city street coming off of the horizon. Now, this is the beginning of our fourth lesson. It's our second lesson dealing with the elements of art. So let's move into the second element. Blank is a two-dimensional unit in a work of art. It has height and width, meaning we can only measure how tall it is and how wide it is. Shapes. Let's talk about shapes. Over the next 2 weeks, we're going to be discussing the different kinds of shapes. So today, let's talk about the first kinds of shapes. What do you call shapes that are based on math rules? Geometric shapes are shapes that are based on math rules, meaning you have to have a rule, and everybody knows these rules. I know if you're in kindergarten, this might be your first year in school, but I can guarantee you're going to know most of these shapes. So let's test your knowledge. Can you name the shapes that pop up on the screen before I name them? Are you ready? Get set. Go. Circle. Square. Triangle. Rectangle. Oval. Heart. Now, those are really easy. I bet you got every one of them right, and I bet you said it before I did. What I do is I call those simple geometric shapes because they have simple rules. How'd you know that was a circle and not call that one a square? Well, a circle has no straight lines, and it ends where it begins. If I was measuring it out, we call that 360 degrees. You know the difference between a square and a rectangle because both of them have straight sides. Both of them have 4 straight sides. So what makes them different? If we had a ruler, we could measure the width and the height, and it should measure the same. So if I measure this, the width of this square, and it says 2 inches, what would the height be? You're right, it's 2 inches. If I measure the width of this rectangle, and it's 2 inches, and then I measure the height of it, will it be the same? No, it's going to be way more than 2 inches. So that's what makes this a rectangle. These are simple rules. How many sides does a triangle have? 1, 2, 3. Perfect. That's a good rule for a triangle. Now, since you know the simple so well, let's see if I can teach you some complex geometric shapes. Complex geometric shapes have a little bit more complicated rules, and usually there are simple shapes hiding in the complex shape. For example, what's that purple shape? Yes, it is a diamond, but guess what shapes are hiding in that diamond? Two triangles. All right, let's see if you can name these other complex shapes and see if you can tell me what shapes are hiding in them. Ready? Now, I give you a hint. It's a trap. Yes, it's a trapezoid. A trapezoid has how many triangles hiding inside? You're right. One, two, three. Okay, what shape is this? It's a six-sided shape. What do you call the six-sided shape? That's a little tricky. It's not an octagon. Octagon has eight sides. This only has six. It's called a hexagon. Hexagon actually has two what hiding inside? If you remember the name of this one beside of it, it has two trapezoids. Or we could say it has six triangles. What's the eight-sided shape? Yeah, everybody knows this one because it's similar to a stop sign. This has an octagon. Eight sides, octagon. Like an octopus has eight legs. How many triangles are hiding in an octagon? If you count them, there's eight. You're right. Eight triangles hiding in an octagon. Now, this next shape is very, very shy. Not a lot of people know its name. And so sometimes it disappears if we don't get its name correctly the first time. Boys or girls, what do you call a five-sided shape? Well, where'd it go? It's pentagon. If you say pentagon, maybe it will stay up a little longer. All right, boys, girls, what's the name of this five-sided shape? Yes, it is a pentagon. Good job. Now, how many triangles are hiding in a pentagon? We count them. One, two, three, four, five. Awesome. Now, I have two that I usually teach my older students, but just for the fun of it, I want to see if you can say these crazy words. What would you call a rectangle that's leaning? Two sides are longer than the other two, so it's based off of a rectangle, but the rectangle is leaning, so we can't call it a rectangle anymore. We have to give it a new name. Now, if you say this with me, it's sort of like a tongue twister. You get your tongue all twisted up and trying to say it. Let's see if you can say it. Boys or girls, a rectangle that looks like it's leaning is called a parallelogram. A parallelogram has four sides, but two of the sides are leaning in the same direction. And it basically has two special triangles that make up this shape. What do you call a square that's leaning? Now, since all sides are the same, just like a square, but it's leaning, we can't call it a parallelogram. We can't call it a square because it's leaning. So I give you a hint. It starts with an R and ends with a bus. You're right. It's called a rhombus. A rhombus is a square. All sides are the same, but it's leaning. It's sort of tilted. Good job, everyone. Now, let's play a little game. Let's apply the knowledge you just learned. Ready? Let's look at this very famous painting by a famous artist by the name of Modrian. Modrian is fascinated by basic lines and basic geometric shapes. So if I ask you to name me a line that this artist used, I'm hoping you would say vertical lines and horizontal lines. Both of those lines are used in this painting. Now, the vertical and horizontal lines, when they close, they create shapes. If you look at all of these shapes, can you name me one geometric shape that the artist used in this painting? If you said rectangles, there's lots and lots and lots and lots and lots of rectangles, but he also makes a few squares. There's a good square, and this is a good square. So again, the main thing is we're learning the terminology, but it's very important that we use it in discussing and looking and creating artwork. Those are your elements. Let's look at another painting. This is a very famous painting by the artist Kandinsky. Wolosky Kandinsky would listen to classical music, and he's one of these special people that could see colors and shapes as he's listening to music. So he hears sounds, but this is what he sort of sees in his mind, and then he sort of painted music that he heard. So it's very abstract, but he uses lots of lines and shapes. Can you name me one line that the artist used in the painting? I'm going to give you a hint. If you look hard enough, you can name all eight lines that we were learning. The main line is diagonal. There are a couple of verticals, straight up, straight down. There's a few horizontal lines. They're very, very thin. This is our thin and thick line. There's thin and thick. We have broken. There's a small little zigzags that he started in this corner. And then over here, since it's not very even, that's a good example of a jagged line. I don't know if I mentioned this or not, but this is an example of broken. So we actually have all of the lines represented. Just to review, horizontal, vertical, diagonal, curves everywhere. That's a good curvy. Zigzag, jagged, broken. If I get the mouse working. And again, we have thin and thick. Oh, what kind of shapes did the artist use? Can you look at the picture and name me some shapes that you can find in the picture? Okay, now let me see if I found some of the shapes that you found. Let's see if we both agree. So first thing is circles. There's circles everywhere in this picture. There is an oval. This is not perfect circle, so it's an oval. I see triangles. There's a huge yellow triangle hiding back here. There's squares. There are diamonds. There's rectangles. And if you notice this big, huge brown one, it's a trap. It's a trapezoid. Now, there's probably some other shapes in there, too, but those are some of the major shapes that I really like for my students to pick out. Is let's do a geometric drawing using some geometric shapes. So, okay, second graders, I'd really like for us to be inspired by this abstract artist by the name of Frank Stella. Frank Stella has a really good skill of using a protractor to make his geometric art. So I would like for us to be inspired by Frank Stella and create some really neat and interesting geometric designs. And so if you see this painting is extremely large. It takes up almost a whole wall in the museum. But if you notice, he uses this tool that we know as a protractor. Now, if you do not have a protractor at home, that's quite all right. And so what we can do to sort of change that, if you do not have a protractor at home, what I'd like for you to do is to find a geometric shape somewhere in your home. If you might find a Pringles lid. That's a good circle. You can use that as your shape. What I'd like to do is to show you how to use one geometric shape to make a really complex design. So it really doesn't matter. If you have a protractor, great. If you do not have a protractor, find an interesting geometric shape that you might have around the house. It might be a piece of cardboard. It might be, I'm looking at my crayon box. It's a rectangle. I could actually use that. So if you have any kind of shape, that you find, I'm going to challenge you to only use one shape like Frank Stella did and to repeat that to make a very interesting pattern. So give me a second. I'm going to go get my tools, materials, and paper. I'm going to flip my camera so that you can actually see my hands and see what I'm drawing, and then you can draw along with me. So if you want to pause the video, search your house, do a scavenger hunt, see what kind of interesting, cool geometric shape you can find. It could be a circle, it could be a square, it could be a triangle. Anything that you find interesting that you think is a basic geometric shape. Just use one, because we're going to repeat that shape over and over to make an interesting design. I want to show you some overlapping tricks. So, ready? Go. Hello, everyone. I hope you found a really cool geometric shape that we're going to you're going to trace over and over and over to create a really cool geometric pattern, very similar to what Frank Stella would have created. So, I do have a protractor because I'm in the art class. And so if you come to art class, this is what we would use. We use a protractor, and I'm going to show you some overlapping tricks that Frank Stella would have used. But if you're at home and you're tracing your crayon box, which is a rectangle, maybe you're tracing, I found a piece of a roll of tape that I can use the circles. So I can actually do the same project with simple shapes I find around the house. But since I have a protractor, I'm gonna sort of demonstrate this project with what I have. So Frank Stella does this really, really, really cool trick where he would trace, hold it with one hand, trace the protractor or whatever geometric shape you may have. And then he's got this knack of creating optical illusions with the second shape that he makes. So what if this protractor overlapped the protractor underneath it? So I can make this protractor look like it's underneath the one I drew first. So it's a sort of a cool magic trick. So the trick is I'm going to sort of trace the protractor. But when I get to the point where I touch where I've drawn the other one, I stop, I pick back up, need to move my hands out of the way. And in this case, I'm going to go on top of what I drew. So I'm trying to figure out where to go. I stop and skip that part. So it's going to look, it goes under, and this part looks like it goes over. Now on this part, on the inside, what if I do the opposite? So when I move this out of the way, I can create some really neat optical illusions. I almost made a triangle that I think you guys would really, really enjoy. So the objective of this is to just play around, overlap your shapes, you know, tracing parts, not tracing parts, and just fill in as much space, your paper space, as you can, and make these really neat designs. And so as you're tracing these geometric shapes, you actually end up making smaller and really cool geometric shapes. So this will be step one. If this is step one, trace the stencil that you have with a pencil, what do you think is going to be step two? Now, if you're a student of mine from the past, like you were here last year or maybe the year before, you probably know what I'm getting ready to say next. What you could probably teach me step two. So step one, we trace with a pencil. Decide what you want to trace, what you don't want to trace. Divide up the paper with all these cool geometric shapes. And then step two, I'm going to do one more here, is to, now, if you say color, if I start coloring now, I'm going to lose all of these really cool lines and shapes that I made. So my suggestion would be is to use something. It could be a black marker, it could be a crayon, to redraw all of these lines, because if you don't, you're going to lose all of those. So I just happen to have a black crayon really handy. You can use, like I said, a marker. This only takes a few seconds. I don't want to trace the shape that I have with the crayon because it gets wax all over it. And I don't want to trace it with a Sharpie or a black marker because, again, it's going to get black ink all over the shape. And sometimes that stuff smears and smudges as you slide it across your paper to trace the shapes. Notice that I'm turning my paper so it's easier for me to draw to trace these lines to make them darker. So again, you're a superhero this year. You're masking up. You're saving me. You're saving the people around you trying to beat this old Corona villain. And so now you're my superhero and you're saving the lines because if we just started coloring them, they would get lost. Awesome. Doesn't that look cool? All outlined and dark. And then the next step is let's add color. Now, to save time, so you're not just sitting here watching me color, I have one that I've actually completed. So I'll put them side by side. And doesn't that look awesome? Dancing protractors, based on Frank Stella's work when he traced protractors. Again, if you don't have a protractor, you can do this with any geometric shape. All you got to do is trace it and be creative as the shapes overlap and then outline with the crayon or a marker and then give it color with, again, crayons or marker. So I would use the materials you have at home. So I hope you enjoyed this project. It's lots of fun. And it's also nice when I get a whole bunch of these turned in, I can sort of piece them together and make a really big, huge Frank Stella exhibit. Which that's a pretty cool thing. So keep it in mind, if I see you this week and you do this project with me in class, you do not have to repeat this lesson again. And if I don't see you, this is for you. And next week, next Friday, I'll post a new lesson. So I teach a lesson all week, and then I post it on Friday for all of my virtual learners. And then you have a week to complete it before I give out a new art lesson. So again, hope you enjoy and have a good time with it.